Hello everybody, welcome to NEET Crash Course Biology. So now we shall be discussing some important problems from the chapter, starting with molecular basis of inheritance. The first question says, a genetic code is, well, you all know the genetic code is the information that is present on the DNA, and it represents the DNA language which is required for the synthesis of a protein. So this genetic code, although it is on the DNA, by transcription it is copied onto an mRNA. So the correct answer is, it is a sequence of nitrogenous bases which is present on the mRNA. Because notice that none of the options talk about DNA, so obviously mRNA is the closest answer here. So the correct answer is option A. The second question says, which is related to terminism. Now, terminism means reverse transcription. Now, reverse transcription is where from the RNA, which is something which is the reverse of central dogma. See, this is the central dogma, that is DNA to RNA to protein. Now, which is going reverse? It is RNA to DNA, and then once again from the DNA, normal transcription occurs and normal translation takes place. But the first step is what is referred to as the terminism or reverse transcription. You are synthesizing a double-stranded DNA from a single stranded RNA. So the correct answer is option B. When repressor binds to operator, so in the lac operon, you all know that if the repressor is binding to the operator, then the promoter's pathway is blocked, and as a result, all the XY, that is Z, Y and A, not XYZ, Z, Y and A genes are not able to transcribe. That means the operon has been switched off. Transcription is initiated by a very simple answer. The initiation of transcription happens by an enzyme that is referred to as RNA polymerase. So it is option A. Fifth question is, in a genetic code, the process of degeneracy. Degeneracy means a single amino acid is coded by more than one codons, or you can say many codons have the same meaning, in the sense many codons can code for the same amino acid. So the correct answer is option B. The sixth question is, a match the following. Now, if you think about the lac operon concept, the structural gene in the lac operon is the one that codes for the specific proteins beta-galactosidase, transacetylase and permease. And then you have the operator gene. The operator gene is the one where the repressor protein comes and binds, isn't it? So the repressor protein is sitting in the operator region. So B is one. What does the promoter gene do? The promoter gene is the site for binding of RNA polymerase. And what does the regulator gene do? The regulator gene synthesizes the repressor protein. So considering all this, the correct answer is option D. The seventh question says, which is correct? The first statement says peptidyl transferase helps in. So the first statement itself is correct. That is the enzyme peptidyl transferase, which in prokaryotes happens to be the 23S rRNA in the larger subunit of the ribosome, is the one that helps in the formation of the peptide bond once both the P site and the A site have been occupied by the respective amino acyl tRNAs during the translation process. The eighth question says, the functional unit of a gene which specifies the synthesis of one polypeptide. So one polypeptide, the information is encoded by a functional unit of gene which is referred to as the cistron. So the correct answer is last option. Nirenberg synthesized an mRNA with all 34 polyadenylate residues, and he obtained a polypeptide with many, many lysine units. Now, obviously, if I ask you what is the codon or genetic code for lysine, you know that a codon is a set of three consecutive nucleotides. So obviously, the answer is going to be a set of three adenine residues. So as a result, it is AAA or AAA, which is the codon which codes for lysine. The 10th question says, the minimum length of cistron base pair which synthesizes, so 50 amino acids they have said. So you have to imagine one amino acid, a codon has 3 nucleotides. So basically 50 means 50 into 3, 5 threes are 15. So basically 150 nucleotides. But since you're considering a double-stranded DNA, it will be 150 base pair long. 11th question says, a single anticodon can recognize more than one codon. That is because the third the third nitrogen base in the codon in the codon specifying the amino acid is not specific, and you know that the unspecificity of the third codon, I mean the third nitrogen base or the third nucleotide in the codon, is thanks to a hypothesis that is referred to as the wobble hypothesis. 12th one, which of the following is not involved in the formation of eukaryotic transcription initiation complex? So snRNA is the answer, because small nuclear RNA are not involved in transcription. They are involved in post-transcriptional modification, that is splicing. So remember, small nuclear RNA have no role to play in transcription initiation. 13th question says, which of the following is transcribed and then translated to form a protein product? So if you see that ultimate goal is to obtain a protein, and transcription factors which are employed in the process of transcription are basically protein. So they undergo transcription from their gene in the DNA to form a functional mRNA, which then gets translated. So the correct answer is option C. 14th question says, regulatory genes are genes that they are not directly a part of the structural gene in the operon, but they are controlling the operon. See, they are not contained within the operon that they control. You know that in the case of lac operon, there are RPO genes, regulator, promoter and operator. These are referred to as the regulator or the functional genes. Okay, so here it is all of these, because I ignored all the other options. Yes, the first one says it is coding for repressor protein. In this, the regulatory gene codes for the repressor protein. It is also called the LAC-I gene, which inhibits the lac operon in the switched off condition, and they are transcribed continuously. Yes, of course, all of them are the correct answers. 15th question says, the first undoubted evidence about DNA being the genetic material. So we all will go back to thinking about who first experimented based on what is the transforming principle involved. It was Griffith's experiment. So obviously the correct answer is transformation of the rough strain, that is the R strain of pneumonia causing bacteria, into smooth strain. If you remember, he injected both the live R strain and the heat killed S strain into the mouse, and surprisingly the mouse contracted pneumonia, and that indicates that some biochemical component of the heat killed S strain, which is still thermally stable because it did not get destroyed, was transformed, was passed on to the rough strain, which transformed the rough strain into the smooth strain. So moving on to the questions from the chapter Biotechnology Principles and Processes. The selection of recombinants. So the first question is an assertion and reason question. The selection of recombinants due to inactivation of antibiotics is a cumbersome and a very time consuming procedure. That is because it requires plating on two plates having two different antibodies. First you need to plate it in an antibody to detect which of the bacterial cells are transformants. Then you need to plate it onto a separate antibiotic plate to detect how many of the transformants actually have the foreign gene in them, how many of them are recombinants. So both assertion and reason are true, and reason is the correct explanation of assertion. That's why they came up with insertional activation. Instead, you put up a gene which codes for you introduce a chromogenic substrate in the medium, and you introduce the gene in the beta galactosidase region, the color of the culture will change depending on whether there is recombinant DNA in the plasmid or not. To overcome this cumbersome procedure, only the technique of insertional inactivation was devised. The second question says, plasmid has been used as a vector because it has a capacity to join eukaryotic DNA. You can actually include a human DNA in a bacterial cell. So using a plasmid, you can express a human gene such as an insulin gene in a bacterial cell. So option A is the correct answer as to why plasmid has been used as a vector very routinely. Third question says, which of the following cuts the DNA from specific places? Obviously, the moment you hear about cutting, it is restriction endonucleases. Example of ECO-R1 is given over here. So option A is the correct answer. The total number of nitrogenous bases in the human genome is estimated to be about 3.1 billion. There are about 3.1 billion nitrogenous bases in our genome. Fifth question says, the function of PCR, polymerase chain reaction, is in vitro gene amplification in vitro, that is not inside the living cell. It is done in an apparatus, isn't it? So the best answer is DNA amplification. If you remember, by running 30 cycles of PCR, you can obtain about billions of copies of DNA. So it is a method to obtain gene amplification, DNA amplification, or cloning in vitro, not under natural conditions. Sixth question says, which of the following enzyme is used to join? Now, just like we saw for cut, it was endonucleases. Now the question says, joining or splicing the DNA fragments. Whenever you hear the word splicing or joining the type of DNA fragments, obviously the thing that comes to your mind is molecular glue or molecular stitches, which is nothing but the DNA ligase. Restriction endonucleases are enzymes which remove nucleotides from the ends, recognize a specific nucleotide sequence for binding of DNA ligase, restrict the action of enzyme DNA polymerase. I don't think it is any of them, so the answer is none of the above. Restriction, as the name indicates, it is endo, so it cannot be from the ends. It has to be in between the DNA molecule. So the correct answer to this question is none of the above. Question number 8, it says, in genetic engineering, the antibiotics are used. Obviously, we use antibiotic producing genes in the plasmid in order to select the transformants and the recombinants. So as a result, it is used as a selectable marker. Question number 9, what is it that forms the basis for DNA fingerprinting? Now, we had discussed in DNA fingerprinting, we all have certain sequences which are repeated, tandemly repeated, and the number of repeat vary. So it is satellite DNA that occurs within our genome, which is highly repeated short DNA fragments, which are called variable number of tandem repeats. So the answer is last option. 10th question says, the separated DNA fragments can be visualized. How do you visualize the DNA fragments once they are separated using gel electrophoresis? For that, you need to stain them with a specialized dye which is referred to as ethidium bromide. So the correct answer is ethidium bromide. 11th question, you can see bright orange colored bands of DNA in ethidium bromide stained exposed as the gel is exposed to. See, you just not have to, it is not just about staining the DNA or the gel with ethidium bromide. After that, you need to carry out a process called autoradiography. In autoradiography, what is done is the gel is exposed to UV light, and only then the strands of DNA, which is stained by the ethidium bromide, will start glowing in the UV rays, and then you can cut that block of gel and you can elute the DNA for further protocol. So it is, the correct answer here is option C. It is viewed under UV rays. The method in which recombinant DNA is directly inserted into the nucleus. Remember, for animal cell, the best method of transferring vectorless gene transfer without using a vector such as plasmid, if you want to introduce a DNA into the animal cell, it is usually microinjection. In plants, if you remember, it is biolistics or gene gun, and of course even TI plasmid can be used in case of plants, because the question specifically says animal cell and specifically microinjection is the answer for this question. 13th question, they have shown the palindromic sequence of EcoR1, how it reads the same from both the front, that is both in the forward direction, that is 5 prime to 3 prime, from left to right and from right to left, which is the backward direction. You can see it reads the same. Considering that, if you see that, what exactly is the palindromic sequence, the correct answer would be option C. The base sequence in one DNA strand reading from one end, the same is the same as the sequence from the complementary strand read from the opposite end. That is why it is called a palindromic sequence. 14th question, a single-stranded DNA or RNA tagged with a radioactive molecule is allowed to hybridize with a complementary DNA. Following detection, how do you detect where the probe has become bound to the particular complementary DNA on the gel column? That is done by a special technique which is called autoradiography. And here you pick up the radioactive signals given out by the radioactive probe, and it will give you a banding pattern, and you can find where exactly on the gel column is the gene of your interest located. So this technique is referred to as autoradiography. So now moving on to the next chapter, problems from next chapter, that is principles of inheritance and variation. What percentage of homozygous Rh negative will be born? Rh negative means small r, small r, homozygous, will be born amongst the four children born to a couple where the husband is heterozygous Rh positive, capital R, small r, and the mother or the wife is homozygous, small r, small r. So if you cross capital R, small r, the gametes produced by the father, with small r, the gametes produced by the mother, the children will have the following genotypes. Now, if you notice, half of them will express the dominant condition. That is, they're asking what percentage of homozygous small r. See, homozygous small r or recessive, 50% of them in the children are homozygous recessive. So the correct answer is small, that is second option, 50%. Second question is, if the fetus is Rh positive and the mother is Rh negative, you all are aware, if the fetus is Rh positive, during the childbirth, some of the fetal blood leaks into the mother's system. So you can see what happens is, the fetus will transmit its antigen into the mother's system and the mother is said to be sensitized after this happens. So the correct answer is option A. Third question says, which is correct for a person with blood group O? A person with blood group O has no antigen A and antigen B on his RBCs. This should not be antigen, antibody, it should be antigen. So both the antigens are missing on his RBC. This is also correct. Second option says his plasma has both antibodies A and B. So both are correct. So the correct answer here is option A as well as option B, that is option C. Fourth question says, the most common type of hemophilia is caused due to the lack of or congenital absence of the anti-hemophilic factor. Among all the given options, the anti-hemophilic factor is factor 8. So option C is the correct answer. Fifth question says, a colorblind daughter is born. A colorblind daughter will have two X chromosomes, and on both her X chromosomes, she will have small c and small c. So a colorblind daughter can only be born if her mother is also a carrier and the father also carries a colorblind allele on his X chromosome. Obviously, because the father is hemizygous, if he carries an X chromosome with a small c allele, he will be colorblind. So the correct answer is option B. A colorblind father may have a normal daughter but is again a colorblind grandson. See, there is a skip generation pattern. Now the grandfather has colorblind but his daughter is normal, but his grandson is having colorblindness. So this kind of a skip generation pattern is only seen in the case of X-linked recessive or sex-linked inheritance. So the correct answer is X chromosome and recessive. Remember, the statement talks about skip generation pattern. The grandparent has it, his son or daughter does not have it, his grandson has it. And can you see how it is sex specific? The grandfather is passing on to his grandson, not to his daughter. So there is skip generation pattern, that is a classic feature of X-linked recessive alleles. Seventh question says, one way of determining the sex-linked inheritance is, sons resemble, I was just telling you, along with the skip generation pattern, there is another pattern that is seen in sex-linked inheritance, which is called crisscross inheritance pattern, where the sons inherit the gene from the mother and the daughters inherit the genes from the father. So remember, this property of sex-linked inheritance is called the crisscross inheritance pattern. The eighth question says, mental retardation in a man associated with sex chromosomal abnormality. Usually we see mental retardation in Klinefelter syndrome, that is obviously because of an increase in the number of X chromosomes. So the correct answer is number of X chromosome increases. Drosophila melanogaster, remember, in Drosophila melanogaster the diploid number is only 8. So considering the diploid number of 8, there are 3 pairs of autosomes, 3 twos are 6 chromosomes of autosomes plus 2, that is 1 pair of 6 chromosomes. So 6 plus 2 is equal to 8, that is 2n, or diploid number is 8. The diploid number is so less, and that's why Drosophila is most sought after in genetic studies. It is considered to be a model organism or a Cinderella of genetics. So it is last option. If a cross is between two individuals producing 50% dominant and 50% recessive, then obviously if you take the first option, let us try with the first option itself, you take capital A gamete, small a gamete from this genotype, and small a gamete and small a gamete from this genotype. So you have capital A, small a, capital A, small a, small a, small a, small a, small a. So notice 50% of them will express dominant phenotype and 50% of them will express recessive phenotype. So the correct option, the correct answer happens to be the first option itself. Now moving on to the last chapter in this crash course section, that is evolution. The thorn of Bougainvillea, which happens to be a modification of axillary bud, and tendril of cucurbita, which is also from the axillary bud. They have a common origin and common structure but are modified for different function. Thorn is meant for protection and tendril is meant for mechanical support. When functions are different, you know what the structures are called. The structures are referred to as homologous structures. So it is option C. Which of the following is a vestigial structure in man? In man, wisdom teeth is considered to be the vestigial structure. You know that vestigial structures are remnants of, probably over the course of evolution, we have lost control over these structures, or they do not have any seemingly evident function in our body today. Third question says, in case of Darwin's theory, what is wrong? Now, Darwin theory, not exactly what is wrong, what Darwin did not look at is the correct way of putting it. Darwin kept talking about a fitter and fitter organism struggle for existence, but Darwin did not know the genetic basis of how the fitter organisms come. Today we know that the fittest of organisms have the best of genetic variation. So Darwin did not explain arrival of the fittest. How exactly does an organism become fit, or what is the genetic basis of fitness, was not dealt with by Charles Darwin in his theory. So the correct answer to question 3 is option A. Question 4 is again a match the following question. Let us match it here. T.R. Malthus is known to write, is known to have written an essay on population, and it greatly inspired Darwin to come up with his theory of natural selection. So A is 3, and then Charles Lyell is famous for his principles of geology. So B is 4. Wiesmann conducted experiments on rats. He cut off the tails of the rats, newborn rats, for several generations, and yet they gave birth to tailed embryos or tailed rats itself. So he said that somatic cells are not carrying on inheritance, they are mostly the germinal cells. So he gave the theory of germplasm, that is germinal selection. See, August Wiesmann is germinal selection. Lamarck was the one who wrote a book called Philosophie Zoologique. So it is the second one in the column 2 is matched with Lamarck from column 1. Alfred Russel Wallis, he said that there is a general tendency for varieties to keep shifting from their original type, so that there is a constant change in the environment. So considering all this, it is the third option which is the correct answer. Genetic drift, all of you remember, a sudden shift in allelic frequency which happens purely as a chance process, is mostly seen in a small isolated population. Like I've always told you, if there are only 10 students in a class and if one goes missing, I can clearly tell, oh, one is absent today. If there are 1000 students in the class and if one goes missing, I can barely notice it. So remember, when there is a small isolated population, if any change is happening in the isolated population, such as a genetic drift, it quickly becomes noticeable. It is quickly operative in a small isolated population. Directional selection. Now, when in directional selection, nature usually favors one extreme of a phenotype. Like I had told you, if you have tall and dwarf plants, if nature favors either the tall, which is one extreme, or the dwarf, which is another extreme, then it is called directional selection. So the correct answer is option A. Seventh question says, some organisms escape detection from enemies by resembling the other. When you try and resemble the other organism in order to protect yourself from an enemy, then it is referred to as mimicry. It is a classic case of mimicry. So the correct answer to the seventh question is mimicry. Geographic and reproductive isolations are most closely associated with, whenever there's a geographical barrier between populations, say for example between population, a patch of a river or a sea or an ocean or a mountain range or a desert suddenly appears, suddenly as in it takes thousands of years, but in just speaking terms I'm saying, or if say within a group of species some of them get mutated and they cannot reproduce with other members of that population, then what will happen to that isolated population? They will drastically become so distinct from the other members that they emerge as new species. So the correct answer is, these are the basis for speciation. Ninth question says the concept of biological species. Biological species means you can consider an organism as belonging to a particular species only if it can biologically reproduce with the other members of the group in order to produce a fertile offspring. And this biological species concept, where for you to call an organism as belonging to a species, it should be capable of reproducing to produce a fertile offspring, was proposed by Ernst Mayr. So it is the second option is the correct answer for this question. Most of the time species are identified by their appearance. Now why most of the time it is identified by their appearance? Obviously because it is the most convenient way, but do not think that this is the foolproof way of identifying species. Sometimes member belonging to the same species may look very very different from each other, but they may be genetically very similar and they may produce a fertile offspring, or probably they share a lot of genetic identity with each other. So not necessarily are all members of the species looking alike. So it is not entirely correct to consider only the appearance or the morphological features. Along with morphological features, nowadays they're looking into evolutionary history, genetic relatedness, in order to map the species family tree. Okay, so here of course it is most of the times identified by appearance because it is the most convenient way in order to identify species. Darwin failed to notice the importance of. Now, what didn't Darwin give importance to? He was completely negligent about mutations. He did not even use the word mutations. He used the word spots. He said that there may be certain changes, spots, which may happen in the genetic, which may happen in a particular species, where suddenly changes may occur, but he called it spots and he did not give it that much importance. Of course, later when Hugo de Vries proposed his theory of mutation, he was the one who identified that sometimes a mutation, even a single mutation, can result in speciation. As you all know, the single step large mutation resulting in speciation is called as saltation. Of course, Darwin failed to notice the importance of mutations, which he called them as spots. So here the correct answer is option B. The process by which, the 12th question says, the process by which organisms with different evolutionary histories evolve similar adaptations. So they are not related to each other, but unrelated species are similar in terms of their adaptations because they occupy similar habitats. Now this is possible only in the case of convergent evolution, isn't it? It is a case which gives rise to analogous organs, where totally unrelated groups, unrelated species develop similar organs or develop similar adaptations because they live under similar set of environmental challenges, and this is a case of convergent evolution. So the correct answer is option D. 14th one, the population, I'm sorry, the answer has already been shown here. The population dynamics of a species is regulated basically by climate. Of course, climate matters. Of course, how it competes within the members, and also intra and interspecific. Within is intraspecific interaction or competition, and between is interspecific competition, and of course food supply, raw materials in the surrounding environment. So the correct answer is all of the above. All of the above determine the population dynamics of the species in a population. The 15th and the last question, survival of the fittest is the basic principle of competition. It is its importance in organic evolution. A very simple question. Who was the one, even though the word survival of the fittest, the phrase survival of the fittest was given by Herbert Spencer, actually the scientist who stressed upon this concept survival of the fittest was Charles Darwin in his famous theory, the theory of origin of species by natural selection. So survival of the fittest was emphasized mostly by Charles Darwin. So the 15th question, the correct answer is option A. So with this, we complete the problem solving or the practice question session of this crash course. Thank you.